floor collapsed. So the only thing holding it up from the basement floor is it's resting on the front.
That's a good one.
Lovely.
Yeah, that's good.
That's a good one, yeah.
Did you see it?
I don't have any problem. I just told him, put them on your, put it on your. Eloquently.
Tried the question on, you know, when he was emailing.
I think, yeah, I thought it was a little ambiguous.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, good evening.
It's usually right.
Welcome to our regularly scheduled meeting of January 17th, 2017, of the Town Council. Deputy, if you can lead us in the pledge.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dolores?
Counselor Bello.
Here.
Counselor Hemmen.
Here.
Counselor Hurley.
Here.
Counselor Latina.
Here.
Counselor Martino.
Here.
Counselor Rell.
Here.
Counselor Spinella.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Barry.
Here.
And Mayor Montaneri.
Here. Thank you, Dolores. We start with two hearing items. First, before regular public comment, is anybody here wishing to speak on the two hearing items? One is an ordinance regarding Article of Chapter 10 of the Code, Advisory Committee on Energy, and the other is on information and technology. Anybody here wishing to speak on either of those items that are on for this evening? No one here to speak on those items. Okay, I'll declare those hearings closed, and we'll move into regular general public comment. Anyone wishing to speak? Tom?
Good evening. Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walcott Hill Road. I attended a meeting the other night, the environmental impact study on the airport. Quite a crowd here. A lot of upset people. I read that report, or breezed through it, and for those of you that weren't here, the basic premise is you can do nothing to resolve the tree issue with the airport approach. You can cut a lot of trees, which nobody wants to do, or you can do some selective tree cutting. If you looked at that approach, the approach to the airport from the south, the approach that goes basically over Weathersfield, the one that people are always complaining about, the noise and so forth, that's a non-precision instrument approach. And if you saw the graphics that they presented, it's the widest and shallowest approach to the airport. It covers a very broad area with a 34-to-1 glide slope. It's going to affect a lot of area, a lot of trees. And the person that gave the presentation, they were able to show you all the projections of the trees into that plane, if you will. The other three land approaches are visual approaches, and it's a steeper approach and a lot smaller, so it impacts a lot less area. Back in 2012, there was a proposal to discontinue the east-west runway, just eliminate the runway as a means of avoiding all the tree cutting along the Connecticut River. That proposal was rejected by the FAA because you need two runways in directions depending on wind and so forth. I would like to suggest that somebody make an inquiry to the possibility of downgrading the airport from the southerly approach. So do away with the instrument approach. Make it a visual landing only. It's going to give you a steeper approach, which, by what I read, already meets the 16-to-1 slope to clear the trees. have the engineer that gave us that presentation shoot that plane again and see if we can meet the visual approach guidelines without doing any tree trimming, at least in the Weathersfield approach. That could do two things for us. It's going to eliminate the turbine power aircraft that make the most noise because they're not going to be able to land with that steeper approach. They won't have the benefit of the instrument landing. So you're going to get a lot less traffic there. But they still retain the airport. They still have an airport there that has two active runways. It's good for general aviation. Keeps a lot of people happy. Just a thought of one way of, you know, the FAA likes to see some action. They don't want to see no action. So as a compromise, ask them to reduce that approach, downgrade the airport. You're going to eliminate the larger, noisier aircraft and reduce the traffic. And at the same time, eliminate the need for a lot of the tree cutting. You're still going to have to address the east-west tree cutting, but I think Weathersfield could leave that up to Hartford and East Hartford to argue that point. The other item I want to bring up is just kind of a minor thing. The crosswalk that they put in front of D&D Market, Beverly Road and Walcott Hill. They did a nice job on it. You have to walk a little bit to the south to use the crosswalk. Everything seemed fine until it snowed. A few weeks ago when we had that 5-6-inch snowstorm, whoever plows the private parking spaces piled all the snow up on the crosswalk. There was about a 4-foot pile of snow there. You couldn't use the crosswalk. And, you know, that turned into ice and stayed there for a couple of weeks. I wanted to kind of take a picture of it and send it to you guys, but I believe it's private snow removal for those parking spaces. And I would think the landowner is responsible to keep that crosswalk shoveled. So maybe we can just talk to somebody over there and take care of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Gus?
Good evening. Gus Colantonio, 16 Morrison Avenue. I attended the meeting last week with Mayor of Hartford, I guess, and was very interesting. It's enlightening, and it's probably a good thing that we should look on these universities and the other one, I guess. Which one is it? The university, they don't pay any taxes at all, and hospitals. You know, this regulation probably came about years and years ago when the university, I went to school the first year at UConn with $600, you know. Now this university, it needs like, you know, $40,000, $50,000 a year. It's about time that they would share and start paying some property tax within these city limits, I guess, you know. It was very enlightening meeting. At the end of the meeting, I made some comments regarding our contract right here that it went, the first year 2.2% and whatnot. And at the end of the meeting, the town manager approached me and he started basically saying that I do not understand. And it was like, and it was almost a screaming match. And the town manager has approached me before too. Last year sometimes in the parking lot, and he said, you do not understand. You're not going to get anything out of this anymore.
I didn't say that, Gus. You keep putting words in my mouth.
Okay.
That's not what I said.
So,
and I didn't argue with you.
Regarding the stop sign, last Monday night, I get upset. I never touched him, and I talk with my hands. You know, he says, you're fine. I walked away from him. I also walked away from him last year sometimes when he approached me outside, you know, saying that you don't understand, you're not going to get this and that. And I do not understand. But just for the facts. Just for the facts. I came to this country in 1962. November 4th, 1962. I didn't even know a word of English. I attended Hartford High. I attended Buckley. And I graduated in 1966. From there, I went to, after that, I went 1 year at the University of Hartford. After 1 year, I forget it, it was too much money. $1,400 in 1 year was astronomical then. And I transferred to UConn. 4 years later, I got an engineering degree. I still could not speak the language, but yet I graduated on the top 10% of my class, was a member of the Chi Epsilon. So now, years later, I'm being told that I do not understand. Let me go a step further. During the construction or reconstruction of the sidewalk, when it was almost done, I brought up the fact that where the road was wide and there was not enough bituminous, they had to take a test hole, find out that the bituminous was 2 inches instead of 4. They had to replace it. I still do not understand. In the back of the new curbing, the plans called for removal of existing pavement. It was never removed until I brought it up, the question, and they had to stop it, and they saw cut a little bit, and they just removed the pavement. Even when I brought it up, it was not done correctly, because the pavement consists not just of the 4 inches of bituminous pavement. It consists also of the gravel and the subbase. That's why everybody has a problem, basically, growing grass between the curb and sidewalk on Morrison Avenue. Morrison Avenue and Silas Dean, there is an existing stop sign. The stop sign is located between the curb and sidewalk. In the westbound direction, there is an existing sign. That sign is between a curb and sidewalk. The stop sign at Orchard and Morrison Avenue, it's in the back of the sidewalk. Why? I asked the question. And I got a couple answers. But the one that pisses me off the most is because it says, it's our right of way anyway. We can put it any place you want it, I guess. That's fine. As you go, travel west, you still see basically no parking sign on the south side of Morrison Avenue, which is in the back of the sidewalk. As you approach toward the Walker Hill, you see a stop sign. It's in the back of the sidewalk. I've been asking that for so many times, and it are still there. I also asked the question that the only place that I ever seen it, where we have one stop sign in one direction and not the other, there is always a sign that tells you oncoming car doesn't stop. Now, I pay attention. Rocky Hill, Hartford and Wethersfield. Every time you have a stop sign in one direction and not the other, there is always another sign there telling you that basically oncoming cars doesn't stop. Why don't we have another sign there? How long does it take? Let me talk about this one too now. The intersectional sight distance from Orchard at Hillcrest, looking west, it's 970 feet. There is an existing stop sign in the eastbound direction. The same intersection, when you look toward the Silas Dean, the intersectional sight distance is 344 feet. We still have a stop sign there. Orchard Street, as you approach Morrison Avenue, and you're looking toward Silas Dean, there is a stop sign in the westbound direction. The intersectional sight distance is 290 feet. You need it. It's okay. Now, I brought it up many, many, many times, and this is not going to be the last time. On Tifton, as you approach Morrison Avenue and you're looking west, the intersectional sight distance is only 232 feet. There is no stop sign. I asked why, and I'm going to be asking why until something gets done. The intersection site distance for 225 feet, the speed is good for 20 miles per hour. 225, 20 miles per hour. 280 is 25. That intersection at Tifton is good only for 24 miles per hour. And the posted speed on Morrison Avenue is 25, and the 85th percentile is 31 miles per hour. And nobody out there has questioned it. Now, Mr. Town Manager, I respect your opinion, but from now on, please do not talk to me in private. If you have anything to say, say it in public. Thank you.
Mike?
Mike Cuttigan, 49 West Oak Road. I want to talk briefly about the Brainerd Airport tree situation. Understand from reading the easement and the restrictions on it that we can't really stop the trees from being cut. My main thought is this. We know that there's a lot of planes coming in south to north, flying over Main Street. A lot of residents don't like the noise. I understand that. And there's obviously always a big potential for an accident. Look back in East Hartford the last few months back when they really got lucky that crash didn't cause a lot more problems than it did. Anyway, I certainly believe we want to discourage as much as possible having planes flying over Main Street going south to north. I understand that because of the way the FAA and whatever set up is, we can't require that, but that other path exists basically over the river coming in. That's where, over the river, that's where the trees are going to be cut down. If I was a pilot, I certainly would much rather fly over an approach where there's minimal obstruction, and having those trees cut down, removed, whatever they're going to do, will produce less obstructions and make it safer for pilots. So I believe we should not do anything to try and prevent that those cuttings from happening. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Mike. Yes.
I am Holly Colantonio, 16 Morrison Avenue, and yes, I'm Gus's wife. And gladly so for going on 35 years. And over the years, and again tonight, my husband's brought different concerns to you about Morrison Avenue, and I'm not here to reiterate anything in any detail. I think he's very adequately done that, and very professionally because he's knowledgeable. But I do see other issues that arise from all of this. And first, I see an appalling lack of accountability from the town, because the town has heard over and over these issues, and they refuse to accept any kind of accountability or responsibility for the lack of their own oversight. Initially, the mill and repave project, and then the sidewalk reconstruction, shortcuts and deficiencies by the contractor during both projects were constantly brought to the town's attention by my husband. And why? Well, because there wasn't adequate oversight and because he cared enough to see it done right. He's not just an average citizen. Again, he's a professional engineer with a career experience of 37 years. And a lot of what he brought to light would have gone unnoticed or unquestioned otherwise. And so that makes me ask, how often do these project blunders happen? And I bet it's far more than residents realize, and they should be concerned all across the town, not just on Morrison Avenue. Secondly, I've seen a demeaning and disrespect displayed towards my husband. Gus was blatantly mocked by the town manager when Mr. Bridges questioned an intersectional sight distance measurement he took, being asked if he used a yardstick. Much to the town manager's embarrassment, the actual measurement taken by the engineering department was in fact 8 feet less than my husband's, using no instrumentation. Also, not long ago, he was asked to stop talking about the stop sign. Really? As long as he or any tax-paying resident has something to say, while public comment is part of your meeting protocol, you have no right to tell anyone not to talk unless they're acting in an inappropriate manner. And on the one occasion he did speak inappropriately, he publicly acknowledged it and apologized. He's also brought up other issues outside of Morrison Avenue, such as the long-ignored left-behind guide rail anchor by the entrance ramp to I-91 on Marsh Street, and that was suddenly addressed and removed after he mentioned it. Another example was the poorly covered road markings at the intersection of Church and Main Street when that was redone. And they were promptly repainted after he brought those to light. In both cases, he made it a point to publicly thank the town for addressing those issues, yet he's not been given the same consideration from town officials. And lastly, Mr. Town Manager, I'd like to address you directly. Your sideline nastiness is uncalled for, and he's mentioned that tonight. Has no one ever pointed a finger at you when trying to make a point? Are you so insecure and threatened by someone trying to get something across and pointing a finger while doing so that you have to tell them not to point, such as you did to him last week? You have consistently countered that issues and questions he has raised about our street have been addressed when in reality few to none of them have been adequately addressed. Which makes me ask, why are you afraid to really answer these questions? My conclusion is that it's too embarrassing for you to admit that things have not been properly handled by the town. Don't you think town residents would have more confidence in you and the council if they were to see you really address issues that are raised, or if you could demonstrate a sincere interest in making things right? Not little stuff like painted lines and guide rail anchors, bigger things like project integrity and oversight, contractor compliance so taxpayer dollars aren't wasted, and getting the most bang for your buck, not passing the buck. It's a new year, and I suggest giving it a try. Thank you.
Thank you. Bob?
Good evening, Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. Mr. Colantonio has been up here many times asking you for a stop sign, and I've asked more than once, give him a stop sign. He wants to live in a safe neighborhood. You would want a sign too if you lived in that type of neighborhood and had speeding cars coming down through, and especially a narrow street such as it is. With all the money that you spend, what in the world, why in the world don't you just put up a sign? I attended the meeting with Mayor Bronin last week, and I know I saw, I think, most of you folks, if not all of you. And one of the issues, I spoke about two issues. One was regarding the 32%. That they use in Harford only to come up with a tax on residential homes. And I also spoke about the various properties that the state of Connecticut has acquired over time, and even Mr. Bronin was involved in several of them as the lawyer for the governor, and he didn't give any extra provisions for Harford on pilot money. Yet now he is the mayor of Harford, and he's complaining he doesn't get enough pilot money. So I guess it backfired on him. But one of the, you know, a number of the things that he spoke about, I just want to get back to this. He has the highest mill rate in the state of Connecticut, from what he says, 74 mills. And I looked at that 32%, and I looked at that 70%. And what I did was I took my own house, and I says, okay, how much is the fair market value of my house? And I came up with a number of $276,000. And the assessed value, based on the 70%, is $193,000. I'm just rounding numbers up. And times our 38.54 mill rate, I have a $7,400 tax bill for my real estate on an annual basis. In the city of Hartford, if I were to buy a house, a residential home, one, two, or three family house, and that's what the law says, they get to enjoy that 0.32%, not 70%. My tax bill for that same house that I have here in Wethersfield would be $3,400. Kind of shocking to me that I'm paying $7,400 here in Wethersfield, but the same valued house, if I spent $276,000 to buy a house up there, fair market value, I would pay $3,400. Big difference every year. That's like getting a heck of a nice raise. But by living in the city of Hartford, buying a one, two, or three family residence, you get a nice tax break. And that guy is down here complaining. I also went back and I says, that $276,000 house times that factor of 32, what would the mill rate be on those homes based on the $7,400 tax bill in Wethersfield? And he would then have a mill rate of 84. He could go to 84 to be equal to me on his one, two, and three residential homes. He could charge his people up to 84%, and it would be equal the same as what I'm paying here in Wethersfield. Instead, he's got that benefit where it's 32%, and it ends up where that same home would cost $3,400. Then I said, okay, you got the 32%. We have Wethersfield's 38.5 mil rate. How many dollars could I spend to equal the tax that I pay in this town to have that equal tax in Hartford? And I could buy a $604,000 house in Hartford to have the same tax that I'm paying here in Wethersfield. And that guy, the mayor of Hartford, comes down here begging. He said he wasn't begging. You bet he was begging. And he wants us to give him some kind of a subsidy by regional taxation. That guy's a crumb to pull nonsense like that on us. He's a crumb. I can get a better deal, his people. I can go buy a house on Scarborough Street, one of the most expensive, I don't know if it is expensive, but a good street, and pay $600,000 and pay the same property tax I pay here. Every time I drive by Scarborough Street, and once in a while I do get up there, and I say, boy, those are nice homes, but I can't afford the tax on it. But I didn't realize they had a 0.32 rate in order to calculate the real estate tax on those homes. Those multimillionaires that own those homes are getting one heck of a deal, and all the rest of us are subsidizing them. You want to think about that before you decide to give Mr. Bronin any right to create some kind of a regional tax or whatever in the world he might want, because he's a crumb. I also talked about those various properties in Hartford that have been picked up by the state of Connecticut, and how, in several cases, those Connecticut River Plaza, 55 Farmington Avenue, he was the lawyer for Malloy on these deals. And he took them off as private property owners, took them off the tax rolls, put them on to pilot money, and now he's B&M-ing. I call it bitching and moaning. Think about the Colt Armory up here in Hartford. Just saw his words in the newspaper just recently, over the last couple of weeks, where he's praising that's going to become a national, whatever in the world it is, national site. And he's going to lose, and before that, Colt Industries and whoever else owned it, after Colt, they were paying regular taxes. Yet he's happy about this. Yet he comes to us on both knees asking us to help him out. And then, if we were to help him out, is there going to be an improvement coming out of Hartford? He's going to have the same town city council up there that have put them in the position that they're in. Yeah, a few of them come off and on and whatever else. He's got the same people. He's going to keep them. And I would definitely be screaming if we had to help him, that we would put our own people on his town council. And he would lose his people who he has on his town council. Because his people are, they don't have the ability to even fathom what they have to do to take care of their city. Instead, they've convinced their mayor to go out and beg for money. And that's exactly what's going on here. And, you know, Mayor, I don't believe we're going to be looking at better times. You know, I just read in the paper, Bristol, the mayor warns of a tough budget decisions. West Hartford is talking about freezes on their wage, on their expenditures. Are we talking about freezes? Are we talking about cutting back? I don't hear it. I don't read it in the paper. So we must not be doing a darn thing, because we haven't done anything anyway regarding holding back. We just keep spending. We have a school system that when they want more money, we give them. Now we have a lease with this transitional school system, that little building up the street that we're now liable for. You know, didn't you people think about all of this before you voted for it last year? You knew this was coming, and now we're in trouble. We've been in trouble. But I really think that if anybody wants a good buy, they want to buy a lot of house, they should go to Hartford, because they could definitely get a nice house, I'm sure, somewhere on Scarborough Street area, and pay low taxes. Thank you very much. And I hope you send the mayor back. You know, I thought that he really should have been tarred, feathered, and put on a city bus and sent back. Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak this evening? Okay. Council reports. Any council reports? Tony?
Shared services met last week. We got an update on the merger from data processing from Creek to Raffanello. Combined staff are working very well together on the systems. Matter of fact, next month when they have professional development over there, all the DP staff will be getting together to learn how to operate the new equipment that's gone into the high school in both the TV lab and the auditorium. And their staff is starting to learn stuff on our side. So that's a good thing for the town. They're going to be looking to replace some Wi-Fi hubs over there, and the old ones, which are still fairly new, they're going to look at transferring those to the town hall and the community center and other town buildings to be able to increase Wi-Fi usage in those buildings for us here, so that we can increase usage here. EDIC last week also met. We got an update on the vacant properties, Fun Zone, Auction House, the Vet Clinic, Weight Watchers, and Mediplex. And they had a presentation by the Hunger Action Committee in the town.
Thank you, Tony. Council reports. Council comment? Donna?
Just a reminder, or actually an update, for the Grants Way second annual pasta dinner. That will take place on Sunday, February 26th from 2 to 5 p.m. at the Elks Lodge in Rocky Hill. Cost is $20 per person, kids under 12 free. And this is part of the proceeds will go toward funding the footbridge project at Millwoods Park. So I have a poster. I'll have Dolores hang it up so that it'll be visible in the town hall.
Mike Rowe.
Just some unfortunate news. I know Weathersfield has banded together to help a young family on Knott Street who lost their entire house while on vacation, unfortunately, just the other night. The house, I believe, is a total loss, and the family is staying with relatives here in town. But I know they've reached out to Kathy Bagley and Social Services for support and for help. And there are a number of outstanding Weathersfield neighbors who have offered to help as well. I believe they're in the process of setting up a GoFundMe page. I'm sure there's some logistics just to make sure that it's, you know, in fact going to them. We don't want any, you know, scammers or anything like that. So I would imagine once that's confirmed that the money would be going to that family, I'm sure people will start to donate to them. In the meantime, there are a couple groups on social media that have set up donation sites. Terzan Jewelers on the Berlin Turnpike, Pretty Pups and Mutts on Berlin Turnpike, the Hartford Elks in Hartford on Prospect Street, Property Works on Main Street here in Weathersfield, and the Ooh La La Dog Spa on Beaver Street are all accepting donations. I think having read some of the comments on Facebook, those items that are needed are clothes and toys for their son, who's about 18 months old, as well as some toiletries and you know, new or gently used undergarments, socks, underwear, anything like that. Unfortunately, the family came back from vacation with just clothes on their back and kind of need just a little boost right now before insurance helps them. So if families are out there willing to donate and would like to consider supporting this family, they can always contact me. I can put some people in the right direction. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. The council comments?
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead, Mike.
Just a few things about Bronin's visit. I thought, you know, he had good things to say about Hartford. I know we all are saying basically the same thing, that we don't want our taxpayer money being sent over to Hartford. But after the governor made the two highest ever tax increases in our state history over the last several years, and now hearing him talk, he wants to redistribute those taxes to the cities, I think it's going to adversely affect everybody in Weathersfield. And I think Bronin coming here is just kind of telling us that the state's going to give him money, Bridgeport money, they're going to give money to all the cities, and it will be on the backs of all of the other towns, because the state doesn't have any more money to get unless they raise taxes, and they don't have enough, they can't raise taxes high enough to pay off what they have. That's all.
I just wanted to remind residents that there will be an open house at the high school on January 22nd, Sunday at 1 o'clock. I believe it's one, when I'm looking at it, it says 1 to 3. I think it's 1 to 4.
One to four.
But that is open to all residents. And again, we'll start at 1 o'clock.
Thank you. Okay, Jeff.
Steve mentioned the open house. The asbestos removal at the community center is underway starting today, so that'll start that project. And then once that's removed and we have clearance, we'll install the new flooring in that wing of the building. So.
Thank you. Anything, Dolores?
No. They've got the new election calendar for November and the rest of the year.
Thank you. We will move into council action. I don't believe there are any appointments or resignations, so we'll move to 1C, ordinance for action.
Motion to approve an ordinance repealing Article 15 of Chapter 10 of the Code of the Town of Weathersfield pertaining to the Citizens Energy Conservation Advisory Committee.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. This is a committee that hasn't met for some time. They originally did some work with an energy plan. They did some studies about hydropower and some other things, and a lot of those things didn't pan out. So we're recommending terminating the committee at this time.
Any comments or questions, thoughts? Love that ringtone.
Well, that's awesome. Street Glide.
I was on mute.
Are we to interpret that as a positive or negative comment about the ordinance?
It had nothing to do with the ordinance.
Okay, we have a motion.
It's about Grant's Way.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. All in favor of repeal?
Aye.
No opposition or abstention? Thank you. Our second one.
Make a motion to approve the ordinance repealing Article 30 of Chapter 10 of the Code of the Town of Weathersfield pertaining to the Advisory Committee for Information and Technology.
Second.
Thank you. Motion second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. This committee hasn't met in 7 years. And with the joining of the two departments between the board and the town, with the shared services kind of providing oversight, there's a lot of people looking at technology, so this committee, the need for this kind of has exhausted itself at this time.
Questions, concerns? I know that if either of these require any attention on an ad hoc basis, we could always create an ad hoc committee, so it isn't to suggest that either technology or the energy conservation may not find a place again back in our voices, but based on the fact that it's not a regular meeting and our volunteer numbers are so high, we want to be sensitive to that. So, we have a motion. I'm sorry.
Just as an aside, if the availability of volunteerism is still high, since we have approximately 30 other boards and commissions that people can choose from.
Yeah, and also the staffing. We have to have a professional staff member attend, and we're stretched on that as well. So this is just a good, prudent move. We have a motion and a second for repeal. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstention? Thank you. We have no unfinished business.
Thank you.
We will move to 3B3A. Mike, you probably want to introduce this a little bit, I assume, and then we'll talk the motion.
Sure. I, along with some members in the audience, did sit through the presentation by the Connecticut Airport Authority. I know Anthony was there, Tony, and I believe Paul as well. It was I wouldn't call it a public hearing. I think it was more of an informational hearing to discuss the impact that proposed tree clearing would have on the runway at Brainerd. And being an old Weathersfield resident and on the Airport Noise Advisory Committee, the airport has always been brought up as a tricky situation in old Weathersfield, just because of the low-flying airplanes. I learned a lot being at that hearing the other night. And while there are three options out there, one is to not do anything, any tree clearing, which the FAA does not recommend. One is a clear cutting of all trees on the approach and takeoff of the two runways. And then there is a third option to do not a full clear cutting, but a selective cutting going in and taking out the trees that they could see from satellite imagery that are too high for that plane and field of vision. I believe that is the third option that the CAA would recommend going. But sitting through the hearing, it did, you know, show that CAA, I think, did not handle the public input properly. They, you know, some this is kind of a disagreement here, but they had said that they had reached out to the mayor's office in Hartford. He had said no, but it is Hartford property, so I mean, I believe the city of Hartford should have known more about it and had representatives, you know, at least voice their concerns prior to that night's meeting. They did not. They learned about it, you know, just a day or two prior. So I believe a full vetting of the tree clearing, selective tree clearing, is in order. And in, you know, I think by us talking over the weekend that we should probably schedule or have CAA schedule a public hearing where residents of East Hartford, Glastonbury, Weathersfield, and Hartford can come and voice their concerns.
Thank you, Mike. I'd like to introduce the formal motion with respect to that. We introduce a motion to direct the town manager to express reservation on the current logistical plan without public hearings and factual vetting that satisfies the affected partners, including elected officials in both the city of Hartford, town of Weathersfield. In absence of these procedural corrections, the town of Weathersfield, on behalf of its residents, does not support any continued permitting or progress on this proposal and matter until such time as those protocols are met. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Amy?
I too was at the meeting, but I'm sorry. Sitting in the back of the room. And I'm concerned with the environmental impact of cutting down all of the trees. But what concerned me most was that the airport's in Hartford, the land that's being affected is in Hartford, and yet the meeting was here. And it did make me question why they would have the meeting here, and people at the meeting asked the same question, and the lack of transparency from the airport authority. And then my final thought was that there is, I believe, a bill before the Connecticut General Assembly that may close the airport. So why are we spending this money on the survey now when the airport may end up getting closed in the near future? So those are my thoughts on the presentation from Thursday night.
Thank you, Amy. Any other comments? Okay. I think it was this motion is an outgrowth of that discussion, obviously, and it was for those that were not in attendance. I think there was probably about 75 to 100 residents, about half of which were Weathersfield, half of which were Hartford there. The sentiment of the room was very consistent, and the concerns about some of the narrative that was provided in the report with respect to its factual accuracy were definitely called into question. I do want to reiterate that the council does understand that there are FAA requirements for safety and access to the airport that ensure clear flight paths. However, any movement in this direction, I think, on behalf of the residents of Weathersfield, at least as far as this motion is concerned, needs to be more properly vetted. The facts obviously need to be corrected in terms of what was provided, and certainly public hearings, which were not previously anticipated, as well as it was obviously troubling that the Hartford mayor, who came late to the meeting after being advised of the discussion, would advise the consulting group that he had not heard anything about this. So those are troubling pieces of the narrative that cause us to not want this to go any further without those corrections, at least, at the very least. And then, of course, Weathersfield residents can weigh in again. I'm sure your point, Tom, will be passed on by the town manager, I'm sure, to the CAA as well, as a piece of advice. So we have a motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you.
Can I have that?
So yes, you can. Thing. All yours.
Thank you. Hold on.
3B.
Motion to allow the Friends of the Nature Center to have alcohol at a business after-hours event on February 2nd 2017, from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m.
Second.
Motion is second. And I assume, Kathy, you're here to advise us why it's okay for us to have alcohol at the Nature Center. Thank you, Kathy, for being here.
Good evening. This is a request from the Friends. They're going to be sponsoring after-hours business with the Chamber, and it's a way to bring more exposure to the Nature Center. And the Nature Center facility is, the town has many facilities that we allow alcohol in as on a permitted basis, but the Nature Center is not one of them. So this is a one-time request.
Thank you. Questions for Kathy about this? And you're comfortable with it, Kath, I assume.
Yes, we're going to have
with
staff,
the staff
members
there. Obviously, your staff's going to be there. So, very good. Thank you. Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you. Thank you, Kathy, for sitting and waiting for us. Approval of minutes, please.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of the January 3rd, 2017 meeting.
Second, I motion.
Any changes or additions, modifications? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition or abstentions? Thank you. Public comment? Gus?
Good evening again. Gus Colantonio, 16 Morrison Avenue. Last year, sometimes I questioned the lane arrangement as you come from Wethersfield Avenue to Silas Dean.
The what, Gus? I'm sorry?
The lane arrangement from Wethersfield Avenue into Silas Dean, where basically years ago I said, you know, just to refresh a little bit the memories, it used to be, on Wethersfield Avenue, used to be two lanes, and it would connect with the two lanes in on Silas Dean Highway, keep on going. Two or three years ago, I think the city of Hartford has restricted the pavement there. So, you know, only one lane at a time can go by. I mean, you know, it's the width, it's far enough just to accept one lane. But as soon as you go by, you can make a left into Hartford Avenue, I guess. You can make a right into the on-ramp, 5 and 15 on-ramp. And then there are two lanes keep on going, but up the road emerges with the off-ramp of 515, and that's my problem. I've been using that off-ramp now two or three times a day, and sometimes there is a lot of traffic, much more traffic from the ramp than from the highway, I guess, or, you know, Silas Dean. And one of these days, probably something is going to happen. I mean, you know, I questioned it before, and I'm going to question again. Did anything get done? Did we get to the state at all? I know it's not basically a Wethersfield problem per se. It's a problem for us, but it's a state highway. So did we get in touch with the state to see if anything can be done? Otherwise, if it's not or you haven't done anything, then I have to go some other place. Thank you.
Thank you. Jim?
Jim Clinch, 903 Ridge Road. I didn't go to the meeting with the airport, or I didn't really know that much about it, but I did tonight before I came here. I looked on the computer and I seen the, I guess you have them in your packets there tonight, the maps and stuff. Seems like to me that the airport, that the trees that they were talking about, I may be wrong about this, but it was on the other side of the river, right?
It's on the Hartford side of the river,
yeah,
on the airport property.
Oh, it's near the where the inlet to the cove?
Yes.
And what about the other side? We Wethersfield owned property, but they gave it to Goodwin College, right?
It's in the city of Wethersfield, but it's privately owned.
Huh?
It's in the town of Wethersfield, but it's privately owned.
Oh, it's privately owned?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it's in the corporate limits of the town of Wethersfield.
Then they talked about the other side of the river, and that... We own the town of Wethersfield owned a piece of property, and they gave it to Goodwin College, right?
I don't know about that. I thought East Hartford owned the land that Goodwin's on, but I could be mistaken.
It was a couple of years ago. There was a piece of property over on the other side. Well, they found out that Weathersfield owned it. The Goodwin College did something. They found out that Weathersfield owned it, and then Weathersfield deeded it to them, right?
I don't remember that.
Myself being an owner in old Weathersfield property, in the planes, the noise of the planes that come over all the time, and that doesn't bother me. If the noise that should bother them is the highway, it's deafening, the noise that comes off the highway, but the airplanes that go over, that's nonsense that when people say that a plane comes over and because they come, it's a lot of time when the golf tournament is in progress, there's all kinds of corporate jets coming in and out of there, and they come right over where I am, and part of life. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Tom.
Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walker Hill Road. Just a couple things that I failed to mention when I was discussing the approach to the Brainerd Airport. So when a pilot wants to land at Brainerd, they go online and they get a bunch of information about the approach and what they're supposed to do. And there was some comments in the meeting the other night from some of the residents saying, you know, I don't understand why they're not going across the swinging out over the river and avoiding Old Weathersfield and so on. And, you know, they were told that that's not the regulation. It's a recommendation. So when you go on to the site and you look at the approach heading north, so you're coming in over Weathersfield, they tell you exactly what the obstructions are in that runway 2. Obstructions, 55-foot trees, 1,075 feet from the runway. Use a 16.1 glide slope to clear the obstruction. It goes on to say, airport located in a noise-sensitive area and populated areas to the south and west should be avoided. Approach and depart over the river when possible. See Brainerd, TWR, I'm not sure what that is, letters to airmen. So they've notified everybody that holds a private pilot's license or commercial license that that's the preferred approach. Voluntary compliance is requested. No touch and go or practice landings. In other words, the planes can't come in there and just practice landing all day long over Weathersfield. No practicing Monday through Saturday, 2,200 hours to 600 hours, and Sunday, 2,200 to 900 hours. So they're telling you, we don't want all this excessive noise. You want to go practice someplace else, okay? They're not going to prevent a straight-in approach, and that's a big safety feature. If a pilot's in trouble, there's a problem with the aircraft, maybe he's having trouble controlling the aircraft, he needs to come in straight. He can't swing out over the river and jockey around trees and populated areas to, you know, prevent noise. So they're never going to do that. I think the best option of trying to get them to do something would be to convert that runway, downgrade that runway to a standard visual flight rules approach. It's going to be a steeper approach, less impact on the trees. Leave the trees alone. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Bob?
Good evening again, Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. I'm sure we've all heard that the Federal Reserve plans on increasing interest rates here in this country three times this year, 2017. And that's going to put quite a burden on those who borrow, and it's going to be a blessing to those who need some extra revenue from some money they have sitting in the bank. But the Hartford Courant had an article called Raising Interest Rates Presents a Challenge. And the U.S. may be ready, but not Connecticut. And, the bad news is that the Connecticut, where growth has lagged, the higher interest rate will make it much more harder for companies to hire and continue on. Very true statement, and we're looking at an interest rate trap that's going to come down on us because we're one of the last states probably in the country that has had improvements. I mean, everybody else out there has been improving and doing well and great, but because of our governments that we have here in the state of Connecticut and the debt that we have and all these loads of other problems, I mean, $74 billion owed by the state of Connecticut. I mean, that's horrendous amounts of money for a small state. And that's going to haunt us for a heck of a long time, if not forever. And, we come back down here to the grassroots. What are we going to be doing? Maybe we should forget borrowing more money. Maybe we should think about tightening our belts, something, as I said a few minutes ago when I was up here. I don't hear anything like this coming from you folks. And here it is. The sky is ready to come down. And I just don't get it. Maybe you all have some different crystal balls that tell you that things are going to be wonderful and you can keep doing what you've been doing. But I don't believe that's what's going to happen. I don't believe that's the reality coming down the turnpike for Connecticut. And, we're one of the worst. And it's going to be more difficult for us to pull up and out, or even pull up a little bit, because we have so much incompetence up in Hartford, whether it's the city of Hartford or the state of Connecticut. So I don't know. I hope to read in the paper soon, Mayor, what your plans are for going forward. I'm glad to see the state of Connecticut has finally come out with a little statement on one of those articles that they're going to do something about that. The thing about the school spending, you have to keep spending every year more. I forget what that word was that they use. But now they're talking about letting poorer communities use it. I can't remember what the name is offhand. But in any case, when it comes to me, I'll let you know. But it's surprising that they're even talking about reducing that. But really, they have no business even telling us that we have the minimum budget requirement. I guess that's what the word is. I don't think they have the slightest right to tell us how we should spend our money. But they do, and we follow them, and we have the problems that they have. And if they want to come and take our car tax, they can come and take our car tax like they talked about a few years ago. I think they didn't take it, did they?
They did not.
But they talked about it. And that they would then give back to us. And you know who would have gotten back the rewards? Not us. We would have came out on the short end of the stick. We don't need friends in Hartford who give deals like that to us. We need to cut them off at the pass. And, we have to be smarter than they are. And maybe breaking away from them, I know we can't, but it is a nice idea. I so wonder the Gold Coast down on the other end of the state doesn't break away into their own state. Because they do well. The rest of us then would really sink. Thank you very much, Mayor, and I hope you do something about this money problem that we have here in the state and the town. Good night.
Thank you. Anything else, folks? Entertain a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you.